My pleasure to introduce Dr. Erika Augustine, who needs no introduction, because she introduced herself to you guys last night very well. So, without further ado, Dr. Augustine on clinical trials for your disease.
Yeah, that's what it would be.
Question, and then you've got to an answer, be it positive or negative.
all of those challenges, all of those things that you want to think about and amplify in rare diseases. You have a very high risk for statistical bias by nature of the disease, by nature of the small samples. So you really want to consider each one of these points quite carefully and make sure that you're really doing it well. You know, we may have only one opportunity to get started in those initial studies before something's abandoned. And if you're going to abandon a path, you really want to make sure that you actually answer the question at hand and you do it well. So along the way, and these are concepts that you should all be thinking about for common diseases as well, but some of the challenges that we face in rare diseases, really, they do continue to go back to those small numbers. So when you have a small population, you may not have as much interest on the part of preclinical research. The animal models may be lacking, or they may be relatively few. As we think about many disorders, it takes several animal models often to actually get to one that really, as a field, people can agree well recapitulates disease. And so you really do want to have some options. In rare diseases, we're seeing more and more that there are compounds or interventions that are ready for testing in one way or another in humans, but perhaps the clinical work is not necessarily at the right stage for that. But again, as some of these disorders are really in their infancy of therapeutic development, going from discovery of a potentially promising compound to all of the steps of IND-enabling toxicology and other steps, dosing and other factors, the venture is certainly not quite through there just yet. And seeing that understanding of what the regulatory requirements are to bring forth a new compound or new treatment are often sort of infancy there. And then when it comes to design, those small numbers really often mean small numbers of experts in the clinical features of disease. We often don't understand these disorders very well. Even for genetically based disorders, once we identify the specific gene, we still don't quite understand how that gene protein leads to specific pathology and the phenotype that we see. We may not necessarily understand the clinical features of disease. And even though we talk about quite a few monogenic disorders, the populations are quite heterogeneous. And so when we think about how we classify disease, even getting to a genetic basis may not be enough to hone in on a specific population. So I'll use a Batten disease example. I'll probably use a few Batten disease examples this morning. But CLN1 disease is one of many forms of Batten disease, a lysosomal storage disorder. A single gene disorder, many possible mutations, for the most part, not a great genotype-phenotype correlation. And this is a disorder that may manifest in infancy, in toddler years, at school age, and in adults, with different rates of progression, with different order of symptoms, with different severity of symptoms, but a single gene. So when you come about with a new treatment in what is actually a quite rare disorder, how do you think about the population that you want to study? You would think that gene, genotype, should be sufficient, but often it's quite not. And so as you look at the literature, I think if you look within neurology and genetics journal on a weekly basis, you see a new publication, a new association between previously recognized gene and a new phenotype. So I think we're really grappling with how we deal with that. So even in this case, small numbers, there are often patients who are quite different. And often, we don't necessarily have great analysis data. And so that's something that's really important to consider, and I'll actually continue to emphasize that this morning. Understand your patient population, understand the disease, common or rare, and if common, understand your disease with respect to your endpoints and outcomes of interest. There may be quite a lot that's known about the disorder, but if you have interest in a specific outcome or endpoint, be clear that the natural history of that, the time course, how it unfolds, the variability in that is really, really well understood. And if you're studying a rare disorder, make sure that you at least have the big picture in mind. And what does that look like for a group to have the disorder and have something that progresses or changes over time? Or something that's episodic, what do those episodes look like? How frequent are those episodes? All of that information that's going to help you inform what your trial looks like in terms of patient selection criteria, as well as length of observation and follow-up. These are chronic, multi-symptomatic diseases. And often we're not at a point where there are validated endpoints or outcome measures that are ready at hand. We may be able to adapt those from other disorders, but depending on the symptoms, it may not quite apply. And it goes without saying that generally speaking, we're talking about small sample sizes. So again, the design questions are not quite a few. And then you eventually have to get patients. So there are by definition relatively few. They are often widely geographically, and that puts Chattanooga in our patients and families. And so it's not uncommon to see trials where people actually need to relocate to be able to participate. That certainly cuts down on the people who are not only eligible but able to participate in a study. And so being creative about how you actually get to patients, how you consider out how to make feasible participation, something like really is quite important. And your trial infrastructure, depending on the degree of rarity of the disease, it may just be you. There may not be anyone else in the region or in the nation who's studying or to study. But there may be other ways that you can find allies and find people to partner with. And again, going back to some of the networks that we started to have talked about on day one, networks like NeuroNext, the NINDS-CTMC trial network, you actually have some infrastructure that may not be expert in your disease, but are expert in trials and trial conduct. And again, there may be some ways of putting alliances there. And then finally, in some diseases, we're seeing many trials taking place at the same time. Spinal muscular atrophy is a good example where there are several ongoing clinical trials, or several ongoing clinical trials. You actually may have some competition and need to have patients and families be able to make informed decisions about what trials they want to participate in, but at the same time, challenges of having investigators conducting multiple trials in the same disorder, and again, only with so many patients and how you split those up from one site to another. And then commonly we're talking about pediatric diseases, which bring their own ethical and treatment challenges as well, but these are things to consider. I want to take a moment to just talk a little bit about therapy development and lots of room for improvement in terms of success. So IR, for most of this in the room, what we are studying at the moment may not make it to approval or may not be effective. So someone once told me that if you're interested in clinical trials, you really need to love the process because you will undergo that process over and over again. And so the joy can't just be about success of the treatment. You really have to actually love the science and love the process. And this illustrates that well. So this is a figure that is a little bit dated, but the numbers actually haven't changed substantially. That looks about implicit success rates, meaning FDA approval, for hospitals that made it from first in man to actually registration as a new drug. And the percent of successes are here on the y-axis, and different domains of disease or of therapies on the x-axis. When you look overall, there's about 11% success rate. So if you get to the phase one study versus human, you have about 11% chance of success. In CNS disorders, we're actually down at around 8%. Oncology is especially challenged, around 5%. And cardiovascular and disease prevention, separated from oncology, at hematology here, they're up at around 20% or so. So we really love that process. But when it comes to rare diseases, we actually do see higher success rates. I think there are a number of reasons why there is quite a lot of industry interest in rare diseases. Some of that is financial in terms of incentives, and we'll talk about some of those incentives. But some of that has to do with success. So this is a similar figure that looks at all diseases in dark blue, chronic, common diseases in yellow, and rare diseases in green. And looking at phase one, phase two transitions, phase two pre-transitions, phase three to drug or biologic applications, and then new applications to approval, as well as that overall phase one to approval as we showed on the prior slide. And what you can see is across the board that rare diseases have a higher success rate. And when we look globally from that first in man kind of study all the way through to approval, as compared to what we had at about 10% here, when we take our oncology and it's back up to that 11% that I talked about earlier, actually at 23% for rare diseases, 25% for rare diseases. Often these interventions are getting much closer to the heart of the disease itself in terms of the pathology or the underlying cause. And I think there's that idea that that might be part of what lends itself to success rate. The other thing is that, again, the genetic disorders, even though the manifestations are different, the underlying pathology is much more similar. And so, again, that also needs to be a part of the success rate. When we consider common disorders that use a biomarker or biological measure as part of the inclusion criteria, and making that included population much more uniform, the success rates are also up here around 25%. That's another thing to consider. If you're studying a common disease like Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, other disorders that really do have a clinical diagnosis for the most part, when you can add a biochemical marker as part of inclusion criteria, you really also increase your success rate slightly by making them more sustainable. These are also things to consider. So when you're sitting down to design your setting, I think one of the things that's probably most important in rare diseases is to think about whether or not you're actually ready to proceed. Not so much about the compound, but actually about the understanding of disease. So again, I would say understanding natural history is critically important. And it's not only understanding about how the disease unfolds, but also about the behavior of your particular outcomes of interest or assessments. It may not be as simple as adapting outcome measures from other diseases to yours. You actually need to pile that, make sure that they work, make sure that you understand the trajectory of change, so it will help in designing your study. When you're thinking about small samples, continuous measures are certainly helpful from a power standpoint. Repeated measures, extended treatment periods, I'll also show some examples about that, can be really helpful. And your sample selection, whether that's very mild patients or individuals who have more severe disease manifestations, or those who are in a trajectory of rapid change, if you can predict that, all of those things can be helpful. And we started talking about this a little bit in response, wasn't this exactly, but in response to a question I heard from the lecture on adaptive design. But also, you want to think carefully about type 1 error and what are the risks and benefits of making an incomplete or an erroneous conclusion. In a very severe disease without other treatments, you may be actually willing to accept a more liberal alpha as compared to a milder disease with a higher risk intervention. So there may be times where you want to think about an alpha level that is like an other than 0.05, where you may actually be able to and willing to accept a higher type of error. So there are alternatives to what we think about as a classic double-blind randomized controlled trial. And I bring up some of these, not necessarily to suggest them, but also just to think a little bit about the current backdrop and some of the challenges that are faced in trial design as we think about interactions with the public. So many of you may have heard about rights to try laws, you may be hearing about expanded access programs, a lot of movements on the part of patient organizations that really are thinking about serious, fatal diseases where there are therapies in the process of testing. And some of this has to do, some of these considerations have to do not only with equipoise, but also therapeutic misconception. I think therapeutic misconception is high in general, it's especially high when you're talking about serious diseases, this idea that that research is treatment. There's a lot of understanding of thought about research as treatment, or the idea that if you're studying this, it must be beneficial. If we're studying this, it means we have equipoise. It means that we're uncertain about whether something's effective or not. And some of that communication is actually important. So there may be times where you want to, either for statistical reasons or for recruitment reasons, think about how you enrich your sample to have more people on active treatment. And some of these designs and some of these are ways that you can do that bit. So I want to take a moment to talk about open label, I guess I should say historically controlled, not uncontrolled, but small historically controlled trials. There are very specific circumstances where this can be a really helpful strategy. But you have to know a lot about the disease, and you have to know that your disease follows a very standard, homogenous clinical course. You can predict the course well. The same thing happens to everyone. The same thing happens in the same time course. And you're really looking for big wins. Your anticipated effect size is huge. So big insulin for type 1 diabetes. Great opportunity for open label studies, or heart transplant for heart failure. These are big wins. And there are a couple of examples that I'd like to give as ones that have used historical control and have used them really well because they fit some of those criteria. The first one is an older example. It's enzyme replacement therapy for infantile Pompe disease. Horrible disease where almost uniformly children die within the first 1 to 2 years of age. Again, homogenous, severe disease. And they use a historical control group. The study itself is actually quite small. So they had 19 individuals who enrolled rating scale. It's not subjective. You either need a ventilation or you didn't, and you either got it or you didn't. And so again, very, very discrete endpoints. And what they found in this disorder control study, they found big effects. So on the y-axis here, we have the proportion of survivors at a certain number of months across time, maybe from birth all the way to 20 months, and you can see that that everyone survived. All but one of the 19 in the intervention arms survived. And compared to historical control, as I said, really around 15 to 18 months of age, almost uniformly, any child with infantile Pompeii has passed away. So I think without anything else, without any other endpoints, it's clear that this was a success. You have children who have lived beyond standard lifespan of this disease, it's a homogenous disease, of course. They also looked at how many were free of invasive ventilation, we were free of any kind of ventilation at all in the CPAP or RPAP. And again, you see clear separation between not only screening and the intervention. And that went on to approval as one of the first to try replacement therapies. And so an example of clear success. So that's a homogenous disease course example. I'll give one more example that's actually a new approval, back-to-back disease, so related from child forming back disease or CLN2 disease. Has a new drug approval this year called Selegnus Alpha. It also presents as a replacement therapy. So again, it's insulin and diabetes. You've gone to the heart of the disorder. You've gone to the actual enzyme deficiency and get it back. In this case, it's CNS-directed enzyme replacement therapy. And this is a disorder that starts in toddlers, older infants, young toddlers, and also has a fairly uniform decline. So once children are about two, over the course of 1 to 2 years, they have a really very severe decline in their motor function, in their language function, and then there's a long period of survival. So survival is into the early teens. So survival is not a relevant endpoint for this kind of study. We have that very extended follow-up. But the course, the clinical course, is predictable enough that the average two-year-old with symptoms will have a very severe decline over the course of 1 to 2 years. So you can have a study that has sufficient follow-up to really follow children through that very severe decline. And that's exactly what they did. This is an example where repeated measures or repeated assessment and extended observation period are really helpful. And so this also is a very small study. They had 17 individuals who were in one single treatment arm, and they also had a natural history cohort of 17 individuals. I'll stop to talk a little bit about that natural history cohort. And they followed them over time, and certainly saw non-significant differences early on, but after about 96 weeks, when they looked at a specific measure that assessed severe decline in motor function, they had really almost 90% of patients who did not have any such decline as compared to only 59% of the individuals in the natural history cohort who would not have such decline. So it really took time to actually see the degree of benefit in this progressive disease. So that extended observation period was one that was really critical in the approval of this particular drug. In terms of natural history, this is one where, again, if you're studying with something that's especially rare and the natural history is not well known, thinking in advance, even when there isn't a compound ready to test, starting to obtain that natural history data is really important. So these data came from an international registry, largely focused on Batten disease, that began long before there were any compounds in the pipeline. And by having this international collaboration, they were actually able to age and genotype and actually baseline motor score matched individuals. This disorder is quite rare. If there are 1,000 people in the world with it, I'd be surprised. And so that forethought is something that was really important. And so not only have we been able to age match, but to be able to get to the level of genotype and initial score at that particular age, something that's very beneficial. So again, if you're studying a small disease, whether or not you proceed with the work that you're doing in this course, think carefully about how well or how well understood the disease is, and think about what you might be able to do now to start to prepare for trials that come in the future. So two examples, slightly different diseases, similar intervention. Again, very small samples that were pivotal studies, but they really used features of the homogenous disease course and extended follow-up. Other options or things to consider can be crossover studies. They're really meant, we've talked about some of this in our small group, crossover studies are really meant for for a very specialized or very specific sort of circumstance, which might be headache or epilepsy or infectious diseases sometimes, or recurrent infectious diseases, I should say, that can be suitable for crossover studies that might be developing to consider. They are appealing in that, again, as Josh mentioned, that there is sometimes an appeal to studies that have a greater potential of being on active treatment. Whether or not that is necessarily the best treatment arm to be in, there's something that is appealing often to patients who can't even help that. And if one designs or sort of specialized crossover study where a single patient will cycle through periods of treatment, again, this is really meant for symptomatic treatment, so this is a much more complex kind of design. Always be working closely and partnering with the biostatisticians, and certainly if you're going to pursue this kind of design, that would be especially important in the beginning. Careful consideration of the treatments, the treatment order, the periods of observation, as well as the washout, and the outcome assessment. So this one does take quite a lot of thought. You'll see this very often. It's something to consider. And factorial designs we've talked a bit about as well, where the opportunity to study more than one component of interest, but a little bit about interactions, as well as the opportunity for the smaller sample to assess more than one intervention at a time. Again, there are specific circumstances for this one. And finally, can be helpful in terms of thinking about diseases where and compounds where you want to understand the symptomatic versus the disease-modifying effect, but also in one where you again want to have some rigor in terms of randomization in your study, but also want to have a period of time where you have all individuals who participate on active treatment at some point. So randomized start designs can be ones where individuals all start on, you're randomized to placebo and treatment, and then the placebo arm at a later point transitions over to the treatment arm. And so if you see a circumstance like this, where they start to follow the same trajectory as the initial treatment arm, perhaps like these are representative of the modified effect, if they actually come up and join the initial treatment arm, then they get that might be something that's more representative of the symptomatic effect. Similarly with randomized withdrawal, these are other options to actually see similar kinds of effects, and again, think about having as much information as possible on study drug as possible. So I'm going to move to recruitment just a little bit, and to go back to that initial slide that talked about patient organizations. So when we think about recruitment, there are numbers challenges, there are partnership challenges with respect to thinking about who you might be able to work with, and then there are also physical challenges. These are complicated diseases. And when we think about neurological disorders and we think about travel, it's really something to consider carefully as how you recruit, where you recruit, and how you build in, sometimes financially as well, but how you build into your budget, into your design, making participation as feasible and as painless as possible. And so that should always be a consideration, but ways to continue to engage your patient population is going to be important. And it's also helpful to start to engage that patient population long before there's a study, demonstrate that commitment to this population, rare disease populations are often very small groups, and to be able to build those relationships with patient organizations or with your own clinic and your own network of patients. To build that early can be very helpful and can be very important in terms of thinking about participating in trials. And so there are a lot of factors to consider, and again, having patient input on what the trial design might look like, what the burden might look like, how we would organize your trial, they can all be very, very helpful. And in thinking about recruitment, there is inherently an ascertainment bias in terms of who participates in trials, but when you add travel and physical burden to that, that's how you might be further sort of their real generalizability concerns there. So when you think about meeting your enrollment and retaining milestones, you're really recruiting a very small portion of anyone with any disease. And once you figure out everyone who's got, you know, clinical, who has disease, people who actually know they have disease, there are very long delays between onset of symptoms and diagnosis in many rare disorders. By the time people have a diagnosis, the disease is often advanced. This is probably a smaller square. People that actually know they have disease, people who have access to a treatment center, who are eligible for your trial, and then actually want to participate. You really hone in on a very select group. So thinking about that carefully is important. So working with patients. web and disease networks or existing trial networks would be very helpful. You may, depending on the rarity of disease, may actually need to consider international studies or international partnerships. And building those relationships early on is key. Registries can be very important depending on how they're built in terms of developing natural history and thinking about how to share that information either with other researchers, sometimes actually back to patients and families, can be very important in building those relationships to plan on an extended accrual timeline if may be necessary. Then my last few minutes, I just want to turn to legislation and funding. I mentioned the Orphan Drug Act. This was developed in 1983, where we really not had much success in development of new therapies for orphan drugs or for rare disease drugs, maybe one new drug approval per year. And so this act was passed to provide incentives to promote rare disease development. If you have a very small population and drug prices are what they used to be back in the 80s, there was really not much opportunity to actually make a profit. And so it really wasn't financially feasible. And so this act was signed into law back in the 80s, defined rare diseases, as we talked about, fewer than 200,000. There are also orphan drugs that are indicated for treating a rare disease or that otherwise wouldn't be profitable for some reason. But largely, the Orphan Drug Act is about financial incentives. There are a waiver of user fees for about $2 million. There are tax credits during the duration of clinical trial execution, and then extended marketing exclusivity. And these have really, really driven quite a lot of interest in rare diseases, along with what I was talking about earlier, that higher success rate with rare diseases. So if you were studying a rare disease and you were bringing that forth from your own institution, it's not necessarily something that you're partnering with industry for, you may want to actually submit an orphan designation request, which can be submitted at any point right up until the day of new drug application or biologics application. And it's a fairly simple submission, which is really trying to prove and demonstrate that your condition actually is indeed rare. So it's really about epidemiology. And then you continue to submit reports until drugs are approved. It's relatively unlikely that any of us will be submitting those kinds of designations, but if you do, it's a fairly straightforward process. The Orphan Drug Act has worked. It's worked quite well. And so back in, like I said, 1983, there were maybe one or two annually. 2014 was a banner year, and the slide is a little bit old, but I believe there were 48 new orphan product approvals in 2014, and this year, 2017, is probably looking to either match or beat that record. We're in August, and there have already been 42 orphan product approvals this year. And if you think about what some of those are, many of those are for neurological conditions. So we have, in the past year, Plazacort, Sinerson, Strelitinase Alpha, and we go on and on. There have been at least five or six new applications that have been approved, new products approved for neurological conditions. There are expedited programs, which you'll also hear about. So whereas the Orphan Drug Act is really about financial incentives, these are a little bit more about review and additional guidance from the FDA. They're not only specific to orphan diseases, but they are about serious conditions. As you can see, the criteria for all of these is that you have a serious condition, often meaning life-threatening or fatal. So these apply to common conditions as well. They certainly apply to rare diseases. So there are fast-track designations for unmet needs, where you have expedited review or rolling review instead of standard care. There are breakthrough therapies, where you have improvement over current therapies, and then you have much the ability to have intensive guidance on development from the FDA, which is certainly helpful. There's accelerated approval, which is essentially approval on a surrogate endpoint. So you see this very commonly in HIV, sometimes in oncology, but it certainly can have, where there's a rigorous biomarker, you certainly can have that other disorders as well. And then there's priority review, which is a shorter clock for marketing application. And you can actually have any number of these. You don't necessarily just have to pursue one path. You can have multiple. So you can have that priority review and that kind of thing. So as you hear about these kinds of programs or announcements that different companies have received a particular kind of designation, these are the things that are being talked about. I don't often hear about that quite a lot in rare diseases. And then finally, funding. Are there any unique opportunities that relate to rare diseases with getting your trials funded? And there are a few to consider. Foundations, certainly depending on the outside of the foundation can actually be very helpful partners, even in thinking about trials. Some of the larger organizations actually are fully funding trials. The CF Foundation is one to consider, but even smaller amounts of funds for early phase studies can be relevant and often can be very invested. So there is an orphan product grant program, I mentioned that last night, and this is an annual grant review cycle, and it is specifically run by the FDA for orphan products. I think the actual threshold is probably have increased a little bit since my last look. But they are really looking at phase one and phase two studies. And so if you do have to conduct this under an active IND, whether or not your particular compound is IND exempt, it actually is a requirement of the grant program. But this is one kind of trial grant program that's specifically targeted to rare diseases to consider, especially the early phase, smaller studies. There also is an FDA orphan products natural history program. It's an R01 mechanism, actually orphan product grants program is also an R01 mechanism. It is very rare to have anyone who will fund natural history. So if you are studying a rare disease, I strongly encourage you to consider this. Very difficult to get funding for natural history from a federal source. And this is a new program. It's had its initial cycle in 2016. I know 2018 is far away. The next cycle will be October of 2018. So if this applies to you, consider it. And it will also fund retrospective natural history studies as well, which again is unheard of in terms of being able to get that kind of work funded. But these are really critical foundations for future trials. So again, it's relevant. And then finally, a deadline that is coming up very soon, the next one is in February of 2018, the NIH, NIADS, has a clinical trial readiness for neurological and neuromuscular diseases program. And it's not a natural history study program, but it really is a mechanism that will help to think about infrastructure, endpoints, and other elements that are needed, whether that is biomarker validation, development for clinical trials. And so again, this is another very important mechanism to consider. And this is up to 5 years of support. February is the next relevant deadline for this particular award, the UO1 mechanism. And finally, I do want to just mention again, from a training standpoint, the NIADS Child Neurology K-12 program. So if you were a child neurologist, the current application cycle has just closed or is about to close, but it's something to consider for next year. There also is a minority research scholars program that provides a travel scholarship to come to the annual CNCP scientific retreat, the Neurobiology of Disease and Children program, along with the Child Neurology Society. It's a great opportunity. A great networking opportunity, great opportunity to get feedback on your research, and that application is open until next week, and I encourage you to apply to that as well. The CNCP's website is down below. Then I just want to leave you with a couple of references that are very helpful if you're thinking about small studies and certainly if you're thinking about efficacy. The latter two actually take a look at orphan drug approvals and the trials. What was the content of the trial? What was the approval endpoint? How long was the study? How many individuals? And whether or not the same typical two adequate well-controlled trials criteria was approved or if there was something else. And it really goes into detail of how there's quite a lot of flexibility in the FDA's review and approval program. It's not a lower threshold, it's just that there really has been consideration of the serious nature of these conditions and may give some insights into how you might think about development.